Now we will see about stress and strain. Okay, here you can see the word simple. Why it is called simple? Once we enter into the next topic, complex stresses and strain, you will understand why this is called simple stress and strain. Okay, to enter into this topic, first we have to know some basic definitions. Okay, first I will discuss that, and then we will discuss what is the stress, strain, and what are the relations. Okay, so first difference that we have to know here is the difference between deformation and displacement. Okay, so first we have to know the difference between deformation and displacement. Okay, what is deformation means? From the word itself we can say deformation means changing the shape of the body. Okay, and displacement means moving from one point to other point. Okay, in deformation we are changing the shape. Here also the particle will move from one place to another place, but the body will not move. Suppose if I am extending a bar, the bar is not displaced, but the bar is deformed. Okay, if I am suppose if there is no load and I am moving it, in this case the bar has a deformation and also displacement. Okay, so this is displacement of the body. While I am displacing, it generates something called dynamic stress, which is not a civil engineering concept. Okay, even while moving also we get something called dynamic stress, which will be lesser than the static stress for the same force. Okay, so I hope you understand what is deformation and displacement. I will tell you one more example for better understanding. Suppose if a beam is deflected like this. Okay, so we applied a load and a beam is deflected like this. Okay, so there is a beam like this, we applied a load like this, so because of that it deformed. Okay, now can you see the change in shape of the beam? Yes, initially it was straight line like this, but now it is deformed. Okay, so we can say the beam is deformed. Will the particle deforms? You will have every particle here, every particle. The particle will not deform, the particle will displace. This is displacement. So we call this as displacement of the particle or point, and the beam is deformed. So similarly, suppose if I take a beam like this or a rod, if I apply a force like this, then it will obviously extend, right? So did the shape of the bar changed? Yes. So the body is deformed but not displaced, but the particle is displaced from this point to this point. Okay, so this we have to understand. Basically why means, initially I told you about the types of materials as rigid material and elastic material. Okay, for rigid material you will not have deformation, but you can have displacement. Okay, so a rigid body, if you stretch, you will not have any strain. So in strength of materials we will not study anything related to deformation for a rigid body, because it is always zero. But you will get the problems for rigid body with respect to displacement. Okay, so sometimes because of some failures or whatever, the rigid body also displaces. Generally structure means we should not see any displacement, mostly you will see deformations. Okay, suppose if you see displacement. Okay, so suppose in the case of springs, so we have some chapter where we have to discuss about displacement of a body. Without deforming it will displace. So suppose if this is a body, if it shifts like this, it did not deform. The shape is not changed, only position is changed. So here the body is displaced but not deformed. So such type of problems we will get in rigid body. So when you are drawing rigid body, while solving the problem, from the starting of the problem to the ending of the problem, the position of the body may change but not the shape of the body. Okay, shape of the body will always remain the same for rigid body. Okay, that is the reason in mechanics, which deals with the displacement of body. Suppose in mechanical engineer studies about automobiles, machines, which involves motion. So always they study the moving bodies as rigid bodies. Okay, they will not consider the deformation as serious thing, but they will consider as the displacement. For them, dynamic stress is more important than static stress. Okay, so that is mechanical, so that is mechanics related. But for our structures, we need mostly elastic bodies. Okay, so when we are talking about elastic bodies, which is static, then we talk about deformation. If you are talking about rigid bodies, that is moving, then we call about displacement. Okay, so suppose if there is a rigid body like this, initially suppose it was like this. Okay, let us place one spring here for better understanding. If I apply a load, it will not deform like this, it will simply displace like this. Okay, the shape of the bar will not change, only position will change. Okay, so you'll get such type of problems in rigid body. That is, you can see the entire body is displaced, the entire beam is displaced here. Here the entire beam is not displaced. Okay, so from starting to ending it was between these only, but it is just deformed. Okay, so that is the difference between deformation and displacement. Okay, next, second important definition you have to know is, what is the difference between cross section and longitudinal section? Okay, so for every body, always there exist two sections, cross section and longitudinal section, which are perpendicular to each other all the time. So suppose if you consider this as length, okay, so in any body you can identify what is the length, which is larger side. So this is length. So if you cut a section along this direction, this section is called longitudinal section, which is not critical in most of the cases. Why? We will see once we enter into stress, we will know that longitudinal section will not play a major role because of more cross section area. Sorry, because of more longitudinal area. Now, whatever the section that we consider perpendicular to the longitudinal section is called cross section. Okay, so if you cut a section here and see, then it is cross section. From the side view, if I see, I will be able to see cross section. Okay, so don't think that if it is vertical, it is cross section, if it is horizontal. In another way, suppose if I draw like this, if this length is much more higher, then for this same beam, this will become longitudinal section and this will become cross section. Okay, so cross section is always perpendicular to the length. So first, always you will get longitudinal, and perpendicular to that you will get cross section. Okay, so that we have to understand. Okay, so when we call cross section of a body, means suppose if you extend the cross section along the length, then you should get the complete body. When you are extending the cross section along the length, then you should get the entire body. Suppose if you take a circular beam like this, what will be my cross section? First, I have to understand what is my length here to understand what is cross section. Here, the length is this. This is the length of the beam, right? Previously, the beam was like this. Now, I have made it to circle. So, still my length of the beam is this. Here, what will be my cross section? Cross section is perpendicular to longitudinal section. Okay? Like this. Okay, so for every beam, at the centroid you will have only one longitudinal section, but you can have any number of cross section perpendicular to the longitudinal section. That we have to understand here. Okay, So I hope you understood what is the difference between longitudinal section and a cross section. Okay, suppose if I draw a column, then this will be my length, so this will be my cross section. Okay, so here you can see cross section is horizontal, here you can see cross section is vertical. Okay, so always first you have to identify what is the length, then only you will get what is the cross section. Okay, so if I take this as cross section, if I extend along the length, then I will get the entire bar. Here if I take this as cross section, if I extend along the length, then I will get the entire body. Like this you can select any cross section and extend the body, then you will get the entire body. So suppose if there is a beam like this, okay, we know this will be the length. What is the cross section of this body means we should not say this section or this section. Why? Because if you extend the cross section along the length, are you getting the entire body? You will not get. In this case you have to divide this into two parts. Okay, the cross section of this part is this, so if you extend along this you will get this, so this is cross section. Similarly, for this body this is cross section. Like this, when you extend the cross section along the length, then you should get the entire body. Okay, first identify what is the length, then perpendicular to that length you will have cross section. Okay, how to check the cross section means extend the cross section along the length to get the entire body. Okay, so that is the difference between cross section and longitudinal section. This definition is very very important in understanding many stress and strain definitions, so I'm getting in deep because later we will not have much time to explain each and everything, so I will cover all the basics in the initial stages itself. Okay, so that is about cross section and longitudinal section. There is one more difference that we have to know. What is that? Third difference, surface force and body force. What is the difference means surface force will act on the surface and body force will act over the entire body. Okay, so in a simple way, but to feel it practically, suppose if I ask you to apply a force on this body, then you may apply like this, you may apply like this, or you can apply any ways. Okay, you can apply the force in n number of ways, but if you observe what are all the forces you applied, you need a contact area for this, right? Only length is not sufficient, you should contact some area. So in whichever direction may be, you need some contact area to apply the forces, right? So the forces that are coming with tact are called surface forces. In strength of material, most of the forces that we deal is surface forces. Okay, what is this body forces means? For the entire body you have to apply the force. Okay, so we can see you can apply the force on the outside surface area, but how you will apply the force inside this means these forces will not come with contact. Example, gravity force because of weight. Okay, the gravity force will be there inside the body also, the entire resultant will be acting at center of gravity, we know that. Okay, so body forces will not come with contact, it will act for entire body itself. Okay, so for this contact forces, and for body force, example is gravity force, centrifugal force, etc. Okay, so the forces that are applied without contact is called body forces. Okay, so when you are turning in a circular way, automatically a centrifugal force will act on you. Okay, there is no contact with it, so it will also act about center of gravity. Okay, while dealing with the body forces, we need to study about center of gravity. While dealing about surface forces, we need to study about centroid. Okay, so here whenever you are talking with respect to deformations, always we will talk with respect to centroid. When we call about displacement, which is per the body, here the body will not displace, only it will deform. So we will see with respect to cross sectional area. Here the entire body will deform. So in these cases, when the body deforms, then center of gravity will play a major role. Okay, so this you can see in transportation. In transportation, when the vehicle is moving, then center of gravity is important. When the body is moving, we don't consider this as a big criteria. We always consider it as a rigid body when it is moving. Okay, when it is static, we will consider more on this. Okay, so that difference we have to understand. Okay, now we will see what is the definition of strain first. Okay, even though I have written stress and strain, but still first we have to understand what is strain, only then we can understand what is stress. So first I will explain what is stress in this, sorry, what is strain in this. Okay, so first we will study what is strain. The simple definition of strain is deformation per unit length. Okay. Okay, so it looks very simple, but you have to study this in deep because this is responsible for stress. Stress is very much important for us compared to strain. But to understand stress, we have to understand what is strain. Okay. So what is this strain? Deformation by length. Okay. What is this length and what is this deformation? We will see. This length is not the length of the body. This is length of deformation. Okay. Generally, we will not see that length of deformation in any textbook. For clarity, if you want, you can write length of deformation. That will be a better definition for strain. Length of deformation. Okay. So the amount of deformation divided by length of deformation is called strain. Okay. So what does this? Let us see. Suppose if I have a body like this and I apply a force in this way. Okay. So if I have a body like this and if I apply a force like this, I will have a deformation of, what is the deformation? Is it delta or 2 delta? Means it is delta only. Why? Because for this force I am getting delta here, for this force I am getting delta here. Here for how much force we are getting, how much deformation we have to study. Okay. Not the total deformation of the body. See, if you consider the total deformation of the body, at every point you will have deformation. That is not important for us. Okay. Overall, at this point, what is the deformation we have? That we have to see. Okay. So, deformation means what is the displacement of the particle or deformation of the body. Okay. So, during deformation, what is the displacement of the particle? That we have to note. Okay. So, a particle cannot displace 2 delta. Impossible. So the particle is initially here, the particle has come up to here. Okay, so the displacement of the particle is delta, the deformation will be there on both sides. In another way, suppose if I fix like this, okay, if I apply a force like this, then here you will have delta for every point. Here what happens, the deformation of this particle is zero, it cannot deform. But the deformation of this particle will be delta. So when we apply a force, how much displacement of the particle that we get, that we have to note down here as deformation. Okay. Whatever the displacement of the particle or deformation that I am saying here, you have to note this always along the force only. Okay. When we apply the force, even there will be deformation in this direction also. So the particles will get displaced in this direction also. That is not important. You have to consider along the force. Okay. So along the force, what is the deformation of the body or displacement of the particle that we are getting, divided by what is the length of deformation, not length of body. Okay. Why I am stretching this, you will understand later. Okay. So how much length is deformed here? This much length is deformed here. What is the maximum deformation that I can see? Delta. That is maximum displacement of particle. Okay. So here you can see the displacement of the particle is zero. Here it is delta. So each particle will have different displacement. Here every particle will have same displacement of the particle. Okay, so what make the difference in a different deformations, you will understand once we enter into stress. Okay, now we will see another case. Suppose if I apply a force like this, then what happens? I said the deformation should be along the force. This deformation we have to take in the direction of force. Okay, so if you want to write running notes, first you have to watch all the entire video, and then for second time you have to write the running notes, then you will have very very good clarity on the subject. Okay, so this deformation in the direction of force divided by length of the deformation. Okay, so here this is the force that I am applying, correct? Then what will be my deformation in the direction of force? If I apply a force like this, the body will deform like this, right? Okay, so the strain will be, what is the deformation? Delta. Now what is L? I told it is length of deformation. Now if you see, I am not deforming this length, I am deforming this length, length of the deformation. Okay, are you able to correlate with this? See, here you have to understand this length has shifted, means this point has shifted from here to here, right? Next, this point has shifted from here to here, this point has shifted from here to here, here to here, here to here, here to here. Like this, you can see the deformation. Okay, what is the deformed length now? This one. Okay, are you able to correlate? Here the deformation of this body, 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 this body. Okay, so if you join all the deformed points, okay, so every point is deformed for a delta value, and the length of the deformation will be this one. Similarly, here this point is displaced, this point is displaced, this point is displaced, this point is displaced. Okay, now what will be the length of deformation? It is like this. Okay, so there is no relative deformation here inside. If there is a force like this, then you will have deformation in this direction and also in this direction. Okay, so here you have to write this as the length of the deformation. That is why I have written the length of the deformation for better clarity. Okay, so that is delta divided by h. Okay, now we have to differentiate these two. Okay, here the force and length of deformation, always the deformation will be in the direction of force, that is for sure. But the length that we are taking, if it is along the force, then it is called normal force. Okay, there is another way to define this, I will explain that in stress also, don't worry. Here the length is perpendicular to the direction of force, so this is called shear force. Okay, so a better definition we can say in stress, just to differentiate these two I am telling here, because still we did not discuss what is stress. Okay, and this is called shear strain. Okay, this is called normal force, so you will get normal strain. So normal strain will be delta by L. Okay, so it may be in the direction of tension or compression. We will see what is tension and compression once we enter into stress. So whether it is stretching or compressing, in the any case, it is in the direction of force. The length of the deformation is in the direction of force, that are called normal forces, and these are called shear forces, and whatever the strain that we are getting is called shear strain. Okay, so apart from this, we have something called volumetric strain also, that I will explain once we discuss something called bulk modulus. Okay. Now if you observe the units of strain, the deformation and the length will have same units, so strain will not have any units. Strain has no units, okay? So this is the reason we are not studying the subject with respect to deformation. We are studying with respect to something called strain, which is not dependent on anything, because it do not have any units, it will not depend on anything. So strain is independent, okay? So strain is independent, okay? So that is about strain. Once we see stress, how it is dependent on the strain, we can understand, okay? So we have completed what is strain. Next we will see what is stress, and then we can see what is the relation between stress and strain. Now we will see what is stress, okay? The simple definition of stress is resistance force by area, okay? It looks very simple, but you have to understand it perfectly to understand the remaining things clearly. First, if you are perfect in simple stress chapter, the coming chapter will be very very easy for you. So I am concentrating more on basic definitions, okay? So stress is resistance force per area, okay? Previously what we have studied, strain is what is the deformation by length. What is the direction of deformation? It is the direction of applied force. What is the direction of resistance force? It will be opposite to the applied force. Suppose if you take a body and apply force in this direction, the body will deform in this direction only, right? Whatever may be the deformation, it will deform in this direction only, right? During this deformation, what happens means, depending on the type of material, the amount of force that has to be applied differs for a given delta. Means to deform 1 cm of steel, and to deform 1 cm of concrete, and to deform 1 cm of plastic, and to deform 1 cm of clay, whatever, different body offers different resistance against the deformations. Okay, so what is this resistance against deformations? Why we need force to deform? If you require force to deform, means it has some resistance against deformation, right? So when you deform, automatically a resistance will develop, okay? So here remember, resistance is not the strength, okay? So when we say strength of material, strength is not the resistance developed, strength is what is the maximum resistance that can develop, okay? So initially if I apply a force F, if my material has the strength to resist up to force F, it will resist a force F like this, okay? As I already called this as force, I will call this as resistance, okay? Resistance against deformation, okay? Here whatever the resistant force I written, this is against deformation. As this is resistance against deformation, to develop resistance, first you have to deform the body, okay? That is why stress is dependent on the strain. When you apply a force, first deformation takes place. When you deform the body will start resisting to that deformation. When you increase the deformation, the body resistance will be increasing, okay? So in this way, stress is related to strain, and stress is dependent on the amount of strain you produce to the body, okay? So that is what happens inside the body. Here what you have to understand means, so I told you this is a tension. When we stretch your body, it is tension. But most of the people, most of the students will study tensile stress, something like this, tensile force, but it's not correct to study in this way. To understand the tensile stress perfectly, you should study in this way, okay, this is the force that is actually causing the stress, okay, this is applied force, this is resistance force. Resistance force per unit area is called stress, okay. Similarly, we think that this is compression stress, but actually compression stress is this, right? Similarly, if I apply shear force, what is shear force? That is tangential force or parallel force. Previously we have seen shear deformation. Similarly, here also whatever the force we apply, that is called shear force. How the resistance comes opposite to this? Here there is one twist in shear stress. What is that means? Here, if you see, the resultant force is zero, the body will be in equilibrium. Here also the resultant force is zero, the body will be in equilibrium. Here the resultant forces are not equal to zero. Why? Because there is a eccentricity between these forces which create a moment. Okay, so here you can see there is a moment that is developed here by the induced forces. Automatically a anti-clockwise moment is generated because of the difference between the force length. They both are not in the same line. You can see both are not in the same line. For the normal forces, what happens? Both the forces will be in the same line like this. Okay, you may apply the eccentricity also here. If you apply the eccentricity here also, moment will generate. As there is no eccentricity here, there will be no moment here. Here, because of eccentricity, there a moment develops. To resist this moment, again force will develop automatically to resist the deformation. So what happens? So as this is anti-clockwise, a clockwise moment has to generate. So wherever there is a shear stress, this is called shear stress. Wherever there is shear stress, definitely it is accompanied by complementary shear stress, which is exactly equal to whatever the shear stress. Generally, shear stress is indicated by the symbol tau. Complementary shear stress also will have the same value, tau. Okay, so whenever we are representing stress, the stress will be like this all the time. Okay, you have to represent in four directions. If this is the element, it is in this direction. Okay. Always shear stress should be applied like this. If you apply a force like this, the element will be subjected to shear stress like this in four directions all the time. This is the applied shear. This is the complementary shear. This is because of the eccentricity that is present between the applied forces. Okay, so that is the basic difference between the normal force and shear force. Shear force is also called as tangential force because it is tangential to the contact area. Here I have told you resistant force divided by area. You understood what is the resistant force? Resistant force is opposite to the applied force or opposite to the deformation. Okay, so this point is very, very, very important. Remember, the resistant force is opposite to the direction of deformation. How this will be helpful in structural analysis and also in strength of materials later you will know. But remember this point, resistance force is opposite to the direction of deformation. Okay, while solving the problems, I will show you what is the advantage in remembering this. Okay, so whenever I say tension, immediately in your mind you should get like this, opposite. You should not get like this. You should get like this in your mind. Whenever I say compression, you should get like this. Okay, so till now whatever we have studied, you have to reverse the complete process. Okay, how to get this means, whenever I say tension, the deformation is in this direction, so stress will be in this direction. Whenever I say compression, the compression will be in this direction, so stress will be in this direction, okay? Stress direction is always opposite to the deformation direction. Suppose if I bend the body, what happens? If I am bending a body using moments like this, then how my resistance occurs? This is the direction of deformation in the direction of applied force. So the resistant force comes like this, okay? So in this way, first you have to identify the direction of force and direction of deformation, then opposite to that you have to draw our resistance force or resistance stress, okay? That is about resistance force or resistance stress. Next, what is this area means? The area that is affected by the force or moment that is applied, okay? So the area that is affected, okay? It's not very simple to understand what is this area. Why? Because suppose if I apply a force F here, this force divided by this area will not give me what is stress, because when I apply a force F, this entire area may or may not be affecting, okay? And another thing is, suppose if I apply a force F here, if I consider this area, for this area this is parallel, so this force can cause shear stress in this, true? Similarly, for this area this force is perpendicular, so this is normal force, tensile force, okay? So depending on the area, the same force can become normal force or shear force, okay? Because of this, how much area will affect means, suppose if I am calculating it as tensile force, maybe only this much area is affecting initially, okay? So we'll draw this separately. Initially only this much area may be affecting, okay, which will be, the affected area will be increasing after a considerable length. After a considerable length, the entire area will increase, okay? So only this area is resisting the force here, so the stress will be very high here. After a significant distance, after a particular distance, the entire area starts resisting the stress. So initially we will have something called stress concentrations. After a particular distance, the entire area will start resisting the stress, okay? So similarly, you will have the other force here. Here also you will have stress concentrations. After a particular distance, the effect will get neutralized, okay? This is called Saint Venant's principle, okay? So in definition, if we want to say Saint Venant's principle, you can see, here you can see, the stress is very very high at the center, okay? Once you cross a particular distance, may become like this, okay? So if you go like somewhere here, it may be like this. So after a particular distance, it becomes uniform like this, okay? So after a significant distance, whatever may be the distance, after a significant distance, when there are two equal and static forces, the difference between the stresses will automatically nullify and become uniform, okay? Generally, when we apply force, we simply take force divided by area, whatever the area. So if you are considering this as normal force, you will take this. If you consider this as shear force, you will take this, okay? So it's not correct to take that area. But actually how stress develops is, it is the affected area, the force divided by effect area. This is the resistance force. So the resistance force divided by effective area, if the stress is taken as uniform, even if you divide this area, still you will not get the exact stress value. Okay, so I hope you are getting the value, getting the definition. So suppose if I apply a force F here, I will get a resistance force R here, that is for sure. But how I am getting this resistance force is, if I find the area of this parabola, this area of parabola is R, Okay. So the area of parabola means you are finding the area of stress. Suppose if I take it as uniform, if I take it as uniform, stress into this whatever the area I get, I can get what is the force. If I take uniform, but actually it is not uniform. So if you stress is not a simple force divided by area, it is the force divided by affected area. Affected area doesn't mean you should have total area, it is the local area that you have to take. Means here, what is the local area that you have? Here you have very small area. So how much resistance you are getting per unit area is the stress developed at this point. If you take it at longer magnitude like this, stress developed by unit area at this point. Unit area, when I am talking, you should not take the entire area, okay? So what is the stress here is the stress developed by unit area at this point, stress developed by unit area at this point, unit area, that unit area you have to take it as infinitesimally small. So how much force you have developed within this divided by how much area you have, that is delta F divided by delta A. So among the total resistance R, what is the delta F divided by delta A is the exact value of stress that we can say, but it's quite complex to study the stress in this way. So here, if you have this much area, in this much area, only this much area is affected. Again in this area, the stress is not uniform. It is varying parabolically. So to avoid this complexity, after a particular distance, what happens? The entire cross section will have uniform stress. So that stress into area is equal to resistance force. Okay, so we are neglecting this zone in our calculation, but this is how exactly the stress happens. Okay, so this is important in stress concentrations. Okay, so currently while studying simple stresses, you need not know this. But you should know that there is something called St. Venant's principle, because you may get a question on objective type questions. So that's why I am explaining this St. Venant's principle. So finally, stress is resistance force divided by area. This area is affected area. Okay. So that affected area, I hope you have understood what is that. But in general, we directly write what is the contact area of the forces divided, what is the applied force. Applied force will be equal to resistance divided by area. Okay, so this is the basic definition of stress. Okay, so if you want to tell about tension, you should tell like this. If you want to tell about compression, you should tell like this. If you want to tell about bending, if this is applied, you should tell like this. Okay, till now whatever you have studied, everything you have to make it reverse. Okay, only then you will have clarity on the subject. Okay, so I hope you have understood what is stress. Next we will see how to relate this stress and strain. Now how to relate stress and strain? We have understood what is stress and what is strain. How to relate this stress and strain means, not all the materials can be related, can have a relation between stress and strain. We have to find it experimentally only. Means you cannot find any particular relation between stress and strain. But for some materials, till a particular limit, we can find the relation based on Hooke's law. Okay. What does the Hooke's law says is, stress is proportional to strain up to proportionality limit. Okay. Every material will not have this proportionality limit. For some materials, we assume that it obeys Hooke's law even though it is not obeying Hooke's law, and we take some factor of safety. Because actual stress-strain relation will not be there for such materials. So somehow we have to design practically. So we assume that it obeys Hooke's law and take it proportional, and then apply the relation by taking some factor of safety. Okay. So here stress is proportional to strain up to proportionality limit. So stress is equal to some proportionality constant into strain. Okay. So this is also known as proportional law. Hooke's law is also known as proportional law. But all our structural engineering will be studied within elastic limit, means whatever designs that we are making, we will ensure that the body will be subjected to within elastic limit so that it will come back to its original position even after deformation. We have studied what is elastic material and plastic material initially. Elastic means which come back to its original position. Plastic means it will not come back after removal of load also. So when apply a load, obviously the body will deform. After removing the load, it should come back. So we should design every material such that it will be within that elastic limit only. Okay, apart from that elastic limit, we have to know something called proportionality limit. Okay, what is that proportionality limit? To understand that, it is better to take a ductile material to understand this, because a ductile material will show huge amount of strain so that we can study each and every point clearly. If you take brittle material, by the time you stress, it will automatically break. Okay, so that is the reason we will take a ductile material, that is mild steel. Okay, so here we are taking a ductile material, mild steel, and using a UTM testing machine, we will take a specimen like this. Okay, so the length that is subjected to tension is called gauge length, which is given by 5.65 into square root of A0. Means we have to design a specimen such that if the cross sectional area is A0, we have to make the specimen in such a way that its gauge length is 5.65 root A0. That is how we have to prepare the specimen. Okay, so the gauge length is given. So if you increase the cross sectional area of the specimen, we have to increase the gauge length for testing this. Okay, so for testing, 5.65 root A0. After subjecting to tension, at some point you will have a failure in the form of neck like this. Okay, why the neck is formed, I will explain in complex stresses and strains in a better way. Okay, for now you have to understand that at failure point you will have breakage. Okay, so from the initial stage to the breaking point, how the stress and strain are varying, we will see now. This point to this point, how the stress is varied with respect to strain, to calculate this, there are two ways to calculate this. One is you can test your specimen using strain controlled or stress controlled. Okay, so what is this strain controlled means? You can control the strain, means you can make the uniform deformation and note how the load is varying, or you can give the uniform load and check what is the, you can give the loading rate and check how the material is behaving with respect to different strain. Okay, here you understand that our aim is not to break the specimen, our aim is to track how the stress is varying with respect to strain from this phase to this phase. So that is why what I am doing, I am uniformly increasing the loading rate or uniformly increasing the strain. If you control the strain, it is called strain controlled. If you control the stress, that is called stress controlled test. Okay, so I want to track how the material is behaving from this point till this point at different stresses or at different strains. To plot this graph, I have to take strain in x direction, because always independent quantity should be taken in x direction. Strain will not have any units, so we will take it here. And stress generally taken in Newton per mm square. Okay, so now we will relate stress and strain by strain controlled method or stress controlled method. Okay, for different materials, different rate, different method will suit more. Okay, so now if you relate stress and strain, initially while you are increasing the stress or strain, the graph will come like this up to proportionality limit. What is proportional, we know. So if this is proportional to this, you will have something called proportionality constant. If you see, it is passing through origin similar to y is equal to mx. So y divided by x is nothing but slope. So slope of stress strain curve up to proportionality limit is nothing but Young's modulus. Okay, so our Hooke's law is valid only up to proportionality limit. Okay, but we can design up to elastic limit. What is elastic limit? Even though stress is not proportional to strain, up to elastic limit the material can come back to its original position. That is elastic nature, okay? So whether it is proportional or not, we don't bother. Our material should come back to our original position, okay? But to analyze the material, it is better to consider it as proportional, okay? But for design, we can take up to elastic limit. It's not a problem whether it is proportional or not, how the material is behaving, we don't want. If it is elastic, if it comes back, that is sufficient for us. How it is behaving, that is not important for us, okay? So you can design up to elastic limit, okay? But you have to analyze that it is within proportionality limit, okay? So I hope you understood. You will calculate Young's modulus assuming that it is within proportional limit, but actually we can design up to elastic limit, okay? Now, on continuous increase, you will get first time a small crack, that is called yield point, okay? For mild steel, you get two yield points, that is upper yield point you can see and also lower yield point, okay? In this two yield point, you have to take lower yield, okay? This is the final yield. That initially you will get something called upper yield, then after upper yield means initially after getting yield, after some time you will again get a small crack, that is lower yield. This is called true yield point, because after this you can see still the material did not yield properly. So after this the material will start yielding. This is called plastic yield zone, okay? So we have to take this as true yield point. This will not vary with respect to cross section. Whatever may be the cross section you take, almost lower yield will be similar to every cross section. And from here, you will have the yield zone. So where you will have strain, but there is no stress, which is plastic behavior. Plastic behavior means you will have strain, but no stress. Okay, so this is yield zone. After particular point, what happens? There comes something called strain hardening zone. What is this strain hardening zone means? Because of reallocation of particle. So suppose if we are extending a material, initially we will get a small crack, that is yield. It started yielding. So suppose if you take the different zones of this, initially when I am extending the bar, it is expanding proportionally with respect to stress. And then a small crack came, okay? Even after the crack, we did not get the yield, okay? So then you got another crack and the material starts yielding, okay? So just before starting the yielding, whatever the stress we have, that is taken as strength of the material. The strength of the material is the lower yield point. From this point, the yielding of the material started. After a particular point, what happened? Again, the material is showing resistance. Means, first it showed some resistance. Okay, so we have stretched it. It is showing more resistance. It is showing more resistance, more resistance, more resistance. And suddenly it broke up. Okay. At this point, the resistance is not increasing. At the same load, it is increasing. At the same load, it is increasing. Now, suddenly the material starts increasing the resistance, means I have to apply more load to strain this, okay? This is called strain hardening. Because of reallocation of particles inside this, it is offering more resistance after crack than before. Compared to here, it starts increasing the resistance, means after getting a crack, after some time you require more load to break it. Compared to the initial solid section, after getting crack, you have to apply more stress, right? That is called ultimate stress, okay? So once it reaches a maximum ultimate stress, again it starts reducing the stress with respect to strain. This is called strain softening zone, okay? So this is because of reallocation of the particles to show the resistance. Means every body will try to resist the failure. So after the yield point, the body will try to reallocate all its particle to resist the failure, and it will start giving more resistance against the failure. After over a period of stress, it cannot resist, and the stress value will reduce continuously, and you will get a breaking point here, okay? So that is what happens from zero, so that is from initial to final breaking point, that is zero stress to ultimate stress and breaking point. Okay, so throughout this zone, whatever the points that we have to remember is plastic limit, elastic limit, upper yield point do not have much significance, lower yield point, that is nothing but the strength of the material that we take, and this is yield zone, strain hardening zone, strain softening zone, breaking point, ultimate stress. Okay, so these are the different points that we can track in stress strain diagrams. Okay, here whatever the diagram that I have drawn is called engineering stress strain curve, but actual stress strain curve will not look like this, because actually when we start straining the body, the cross sectional area will start reducing, okay, because of Poisson's effect, which we did not discuss it. So when we stretch your body, the cross sectional area will start reducing. Okay, if you consider the area uniform, then it is called engineering stress and strain, means all the engineering properties, means whether it is civil engineering or mechanical engineering, everywhere we have to follow engineered stress and strain. But actually you will never get this practically. If you have performed this test practically, you will never get this. You will get it slightly above this, means like this you will get, because the cross-sectional area is less, so stress will be more. So you will get slightly above this, but true stress strain curve is not required for us, because true stress strain curve analysis is quite different, quite difficult, because at every instant of time the area will be changing, which is quite difficult to analyze. So all the engineered analysis will be considering engineered stress strain, but this is not true stress strain. Okay, so we are not actually taking the area, we are taking the initial area, so it is called A0 is the initial area, but this is not the actual area that we have to take. But to make the analysis simple, we constructed an engineered stress strain curve. You can never get this practically, okay, that is for sure. Okay, so that is about stress strain curve of mild steel. Now we will see stress strain curve of some other materials, then you will understand why I have taken only mild steel to explain the stress strain behavior. Why I have taken mild steel only to explain the relation between stress and strain. Once you see the other material stress strain curve, you will understand why I have taken this. In mild steel you will have, because of huge amount of strain, I can show you plastic limit, I can show you elastic limit, I can show you yield point, I can show you strain hardening, I can show you strain softening. Only in mild steel you have this. Even if you take higher grade, higher carbon steels, we cannot get this much clear stress strain curve. That is why, to understand the behavior of stress strain curve, we always take mild steel because of its more ductile properties. Okay, every time we conduct this to understand the stress strain behavior, but all the materials will not have this much clear stress strain curve graphs. Okay, so let us see what are the stress strain curves of other materials. Okay, so in exam point of view, all the stress strain curves are important, but practically we always do only for mild steel. Stress strain curves of rigid body. With a rigid body, whatever may be the stress you apply, you will not get any strain. So you can represent only by a single point like this. Okay, so from zero, it will increase continuously without having any strain. Okay, whatever may be the stress you apply, it simply increases the strain like this. Okay, so similarly, plastic body will not have any stress for whatever the strain. Plastic is exactly opposite to rigid body. So this is perfectly plastic, means without having any stress, it starts yielding. But without applying any strain, generally it won't deform. So at least some strain, stress if you apply, then it starts yielding like this. This is perfectly plastic. Okay, so in examinations they may be giving at zero stress also, but practically this is not possible. Without applying at least minimum stress, we don't get strain. So whether they give this or this for ideally plastic or ideally rigid, you can take this, no problem. And next, concrete, you will have a parabola from the initial itself. concrete will not have any proportionality limit. From the beginning itself, it starts parabolic. And the next important thing is rubber. For rubber also we have to study. For rubber, when we load, initially the stress will increase like this. If you remove the load, it will come back like this. So the path at which it is going and coming back is not same. What happens means, suppose if you find the area of this, let us take, what you will get? If you find the area of this, we will approximately get the energy per unit volume. Energy per unit. Suppose if you find the force into displacement, what you will get? We will get energy. What is force? Stress into area. Into delta. Okay, so now you can see stress into, we will write this delta as stress into area into. So, we will write this delta as strain into length. Okay. So, if you take area into length, this will become sigma into strain into volume. Okay. So, if you find the area, you will get area for unit volume. Okay. So, if you find this, you will approximately get what is the amount of energy you supplied per unit volume. And if you find this area, you will get how much energy is recovered after removing. Which means that this much amount of energy is stored within this body. This is called hysteresis. Hysteresis loop. Hysteresis loop. Hysteresis means the amount of energy that is stored inside the body. Okay. So if you apply stress and remove, some energy will be stored inside the body. This is called hysteresis. Okay. Apart from that, in the stress strain curve previously we have seen, up to elastic limit it will not come back, and after that whatever the stress that we have applied, some stress will come back to its some stress will come back after removal of loading, and some stress will not come back. Up to here, whatever the load that you have applied, the entire strain will come back. Here also the entire strain will come back. If you remove the loading here, then what happens means some stress will come back, and some stress will remain inside the body. That is called proof stress. Whatever the energy that is stored inside, this is hysteresis. Okay, it is similar to loop, that is called hysteresis loop. Similarly, what is the strain that is stored inside the body is called proof strain. Okay, proof strain means strain that is stored inside the body. Generally, when we say waterproof, it means that water cannot come out or go in. Okay, suppose if you say fireproof, waterproof. So, proof means which will not come out or it will not go in, waterproof air containers like this, okay. Similarly, proof strain means the strain that will not come out after removal of loading also, okay. So, whatever the amount of strain that we have here, so this much amount of strain we have here, right. In this strain, you have a combination of elastic strain plus proof strain. This elastic strain will come back after removal of loading. This strain will be stored inside the body itself. Okay. So this is called proof strain. To decide the failure of some materials when there is no perfect, for mild steel we have a perfect yield point. Okay. Every material will not have such yield point. In that case, we'll assume a particular, once the material reaches a particular proof stress, the material will fail. Means the permanent strain that is stored inside the body will have a limit. Okay. Generally for higher grade carbon steel, we take the value as 0.2% as the failure strain. Okay. So which means that elastic strain, suppose if it is mild steel, we'll have elastic stress as some 0.87 fy. So to calculate the strain, divide by Young's modulus. Okay, so because we are considering up to proportionality limit, So up to proportional limit 0.87 Fy by ES as elastic plus some proof stress 0.002. Okay. So this is the failure strain that we take for steel in concrete structures. Okay. So this is elastic, this is proof stress. So till this you have some elastic and some proof stress, which means that suppose if I draw a slope like this. So this is Young's modulus, this is Young's modulus slope. Okay. If I draw slope like this, whatever the amount of strain that I have here, this will come back. This is elastic. Okay, still there is some stress, this will not come back. This is 0.2%. Okay. So when it is going on somewhere, the point at which it has 0.2%. Here you can see, if you see here, the proof stress is slightly lesser. If you see here, the proof stress is 0.2%. Okay. The point at which the proof stress is 0.2% is considered as failure strain for steel. Okay. Similarly, for different materials, different proof strain percentage is decided to decide the failure of a particular material. Okay. So that is the basic strength of a material with respect to stress and strain. Now we will see some different constants to relate the stress and strain, and also special cases where you have to find the stress and strain, and then we will move to complex stresses and strain.